But what if you want to actually know what's going on inside human brains? And presuming these are people you actually like. So how would you measure what's going on in their brain? Well, you're not going to stick electrodes in their brain. What you're going to do is something called fMRI, okay? Or functional magnetic resonance imaging. So many of you probably have had an MRI, or an MRI uses strong magnetic fields to sort of mess around with electrons in order to be able to get differential density measurements. Well, you can do something cool also. You can use a dye contrast that the magnetic fields perturb differently depending upon how much oxygen is in that part of the blood. So just like we did before with that experiment with the monkeys where you injected sort of that radioactive isotope connected to the oxygen, now what we can do is we can have you have dye contrast, go into an fMRI, have you look at things and see what parts of your brain are lighting up. All right. So here's an example, sort of notionally, of an fMRI activation. So this is, of course, obviously a reconstruction based upon the density. And here you can see the activity that's being done. This is a three-dimensional reconstruction. This is what a slice would actually look like, right? This is a single activation slice. And these colors are different levels of activation compared against a background activation. So one of the areas that people were studying a lot and arguing about was there a part of the brain that seemed very responsive to faces, okay? And it's called the fusiform face area. And it's a little bit controversial as to whether or not something really responds to just faces or other sorts of patterns. This is a paper recently, 2004. Actually, Nancy Kamersha, the last author there, was a graduate student when I was at the same department. And she does great work on understanding physiology. And this paper is one of the well-known papers, Grill Spector et al. And they're just focusing on this area, this FFA, fusiform face area, in terms of understanding where faces light things up. One of the reasons for looking at faces is that there's been a long history of sort of faces being special in human vision. So there's examples that very, very early on in an infant's life, they have a preference, and they do tests called preferential looking. If you put something up, does the infant tend to look this way? Okay, so the experimenter holds something. The experimenter doesn't know whether it's a picture of actually a face, something blank like this, or something that has the same face pieces on it. All the experimenter does is he or she holds something up, and he just says, yep, I think he looked this way. Yep, nope. And the question is, do you tend to get them looking more when you actually put up a picture of a face? And the answer is, it says here, early minute, just say very early in life, there seems to be a preference for faces. Likewise, there were responses of cells and various other things responding to, this is a cell recording, that when shown faces responds, and when shown these other things, fruits, hands, etc., don't. Likewise, there are measurements using this fMRI of areas that respond to faces. And so this is another paper, another picture from that same paper I showed you before. And you'll see here that they've got different object types that they're showing. And the idea is that different parts, see, so you see this area here that lights up really well with faces and doesn't here, 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 or there. And the idea is that these are other objects that sort of took the same amount of location and intensities, et cetera, but only lit up when the faces were there. So it was an example of understanding a part of the brain doing a particular process.